All right. Now let's see here. Last week, we started looking at parables in my final category, the parables that I've grouped under the title Living as Kingdom Participants. And we looked at the parable of the humble servant in the first subcategory of attitude toward God. And we looked at the description of disciples as salt and light under the second subcategory of living righteously before men. I hope this is all obvious for the way this is structured here. And then in the third subcategory under living as kingdom participants, the third one is in relation to others. And that one includes several parables. So we had the first subcategory, one parable, second subcategory, one parable, or salt and light, depending how you count those. And then the third subcategory in relation to others, there are several parables there. And last week we looked at Matthew's version of the parable of the lost sheep, which has a different function and purpose than the version in Luke 15. And when we ended, we were looking at the parable of the unforgiving servant. And that's where I want to pick back up. And as I often do, I'll repeat a little bit of what I said, and then we'll move on. Now, as I said last week, the point of the parable of the unforgiving servant, it's clear. And that point is that it's an absolute outrage for a Christian who has been forgiven a breathtakingly large sin debt to God to turn around and refuse to forgive the relatively minuscule sin debt of a fellow Christian who seeks forgiveness. Such a refusal to forgive, it establishes that a person is no longer a disciple, that this person is no longer someone who is surrendered to the Lord Jesus. That person will be condemned. He or she will receive what his or her unforgiven sin deserves. Other texts, you're familiar with other texts that make the point that failing to show mercy will result in condemnation. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 7, Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy." The merciful, that is to be a characteristic of Christians. The Lord's Prayer includes in Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, the statement, "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors." And in Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 and 15, Jesus says, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." So it's quite clear, as I've said, biblical faith, I've said it ad nauseum, in fact, biblical faith is more than mere intellectual assent. I say this repeatedly because this idea is in the culture that simply intellectual assent to certain truths and propositions, that's not biblical faith. Biblical faith is more than that. It's the yes of one's total being. It is a surrender that necessarily and inevitably finds expression in one's life. As Daniel Wallace has put it, faith alone saves, but the faith that saves is not alone. It inevitably and necessarily brings with it expression in one's life. See, to adamantly refuse to forgive a brother or sister is to adamantly refuse to obey a central command of the Lord, a command that he links expressly with your forgiveness. So when you have a brother or sister who's seeking forgiveness, and you say, "No, I'm not going to forgive you. I'm simply not going to do it." Well, you are adamantly refusing then to surrender to the Lordship of Jesus. You are saying, "Lord, I know you command me to do this, but I'm not going to do it." You see, that's what's going on here. When you do that, that's what's happening. And unless one repents of that rebellion, one will receive no forgiveness, as he says here, and thus one will be condemned. Klein Snodgrass, in his book, Stories with Intent, I like this because I think this strikes at something important. He says, the fear of works righteousness is far too exaggerated. And I'm telling you, in churches of Christ, because of some of our history and our background, this runs wild. This fear of works righteousness. We are so afraid of calling people to holiness because we don't want people to think we're legalistic and that we're trying to work our way to heaven. So we don't want to talk about that. We want to just talk about you're forgiven, grace, 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 grace. You see, and he says the fear of works righteousness is, he's not part of the Church of Christ, this guy. But he recognizes that this is something in our society and culture and in modern Christendom is far too exaggerated. Would that there were an equal fear of being found inactive. Works righteousness is not the problem of most modern Christians. I can only say amen. Our problem is not that we're so tied up in doing what the Lord wants us to do that we're going over the edge and thinking that we're actually gaining His approval and acceptance by our performance. That's what legalism is. That's not the problem. The problem is getting people to care about what the Lord wants them to do. It is about having them live the radical righteousness that Christ lays out in the Sermon on the Mount. That's the problem. He said we'd do better to realize that if we don't work, we're not righteous. Why is that? It is because our work establishes or gains or achieves our righteousness? Not at all. But if we will not work, we will not surrender to the Lord Jesus who calls us to work, we don't have saving faith. That's why I keep saying biblical faith necessarily and inevitably finds expression in life. If it doesn't find expression in life, it is not what the Bible calls saving faith. It is what James calls dead faith. You see, it is simply believing things are true without surrendering to them. Now that's something that I think is important for us to grasp. Next one. Living as kingdom participants in this third subcategory in relation to others, the lost sheep, the unforgiving servant, the parable of the Good Samaritan. Okay, I want to look at this, the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, the parable of the Good Samaritan, this may be the best known of all the Lord's parables. I'm going to guess that, okay? This may be the best known of all of them. It occurs only in Luke chapter 10, verses 30 to 37. And Jesus tells this parable as part of an exchange with an expert in the law, somebody we would call an Old Testament scholar. He tells this parable as part of an exchange with this expert in the law, which exchange begins in chapter 10, verse 25. 10:25 says, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test." So this expert in the law, this Old Testament scholar, he stands up and he's going to put Jesus to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You've answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" The lawyer tests Jesus with the fundamental question, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And as John Noland notes in his commentary, eternal life here is not so much life after death as life in the end time kingdom of God. And he refers to Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. He's wanting to know about the consummated kingdom. He's wanting to know, how do I gain eternal life in the consummated kingdom? In Daryl Bach's words, he says, the lawyer's question is really this: what must I do to share in the resurrection of the righteous at the end. That's what he wants. He wants to be part of resurrection life in the end state. And he says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus asked the lawyer what he understands God to have revealed about salvation in the law. And the lawyer says that the key to salvation in the Old Testament is a wholesale devotion to God and a commitment to one's neighbor, the latter being a subset of the former. You see, a commitment to one's neighbor and loving one's neighbor, being committed to their welfare, is under this umbrella of this wholesale, complete, heart, soul, mind, and strength devotion to God. And Jesus says he answered correctly. That's right. That is the understanding of salvation in the Old Testament. And he tells him that if he does what he described, he will indeed inherit eternal life. If he does what he describes, he will inherit eternal life. And the unstated assumption in the Lord's answer that the lawyer will inherit eternal life if he does what he described is that wholehearted devotion to God will lead to his becoming a disciple of Christ. That's the unstated assumption. What is the key in the Old Testament to salvation? Wholesale, wholehearted devotion to God, which involves loving one's neighbor as oneself and a commitment to somebody, to a neighbor. Jesus says, you do that, and you will have eternal life. Well, why does he say that? The assumption is somebody who's devoted to God like that will in fact become a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the assumption because devotion to God cannot be separated from devotion to his Son. Indeed, Jesus has just spoken quite boldly of his identity. In Luke chapter 10, verse 16 to 24, right before this lawyer tests him, he's spoken quite boldly of his identity. Apparently, in the presence of the lawyer, including the statement, he who rejects me rejects him who sent me. In verse 16, and the statement, no one knows who the Father is except anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. In verse 22, now whether or not the lawyer grasped the subtleties of what Jesus was saying in that identification in 16 to 24, his statement is true. You do what you have described. You have a wholesale love for God, and you will indeed inherit eternal life. Because you will indeed be joined to me. The link between devotion to God the Father and devotion to Christ the Son, it's specified elsewhere in the New Testament. For example, 1 John. 1 John chapter 2, verse 23, it says, no one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3 says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. This is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And then you see early in 1 John chapter 3, verse 23, and this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son Jesus Christ and love one another just as he commanded us. See, so if it's true, if you have a wholesale devotion to God, love the Lord God, heart, soul, mind, and strength, then you will embrace his testimony about his Son. If you love him, to love him is to obey him, to obey his commands. What's his command? To believe in Jesus. So you see, that's what the Lord is telling him. If that's the case, you will indeed inherit eternal life. This is why believers sometimes are referred to as those who love God. You see that in 1 Corinthians 2:9, James 1:12, and James 2:5. Those who love God. Well, how do you read the Old Testament? You're to love God with all heart, soul, mind, and strength. Okay. You do that, you're good. You actually do that, and you're good. But the lawyer, apparently, see, he reads in Jesus' statement in verse 28, do this and you will live. He reads that as leaving open the possibility that he's not doing it, particularly with regard to loving his neighbor. Jesus tells him, he says, you do that, and you will indeed inherit eternal life. So he says, the way Jesus says that, he reads this as, well, he's leaving open the possibility that I'm not doing it, particularly that I'm not loving my neighbor. And out of a desire to justify himself, that's what the text says. Okay, but he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus in verse 29, and who is my neighbor? You see, so that's what he's picking up. He wants to justify himself. He wants to make himself right. And so he sees in Jesus' statement this possibility that he's not doing that, not loving his neighbor as himself, and he wants to justify himself, and he says, and who is my neighbor? Now, Jews, they had different ideas of who was and who was not covered by the term neighbor. Jesus says to him, how do you read the law? Wholesale devotion to God and love your neighbors yourself. He says, do this and you'll you will live. You'll have eternal life. He says, sounds like he's leaving open the possibility that I'm not doing it. And who is my neighbor? I want to justify myself by having you define who my neighbor is in a narrow enough way that I can be vindicated and justified that I am in fact loving my neighbor as required. So that's what he's looking for. He's trying to justify himself, meaning he wants the Lord to give him a sufficiently restrictive definition of neighbor so that his conduct falls in loving that neighbor. That's what's going on. And so we ask him that, you see. He wants to feel confident. And in response to that question, Jesus tells the parable. It's in response to that question. He wants to justify himself, and he says, and who is my neighbor? And then Jesus says, Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. Now the key players in the story, in the parable, are a victim, a priest, a Levite, and a Samaritan. And the victim's described merely as a certain man, anonymous. You're not told anything about the victim. Described simply as a certain man. The priest was one of the officials responsible for the worship and sacrifices in the temple in Jerusalem, many of whom resided in Jericho. They lived there. So he's this religious guy, right? He's a priest. He's responsible for the worship, the sacrifices. The Levites assisted the priests in their duties. For example, they played the musical instruments during the temple worship, and they maintained security of the temple buildings. Now, the Samaritans, you know that Jews and Samaritans, so those are the two, you've got the victim, you have a priest, you have a Levite, and then you have a Samaritan. And Jews and Samaritans, they had a long history of contempt toward one another. The Samaritans possibly were the Jews' least favorite people. Jews viewed them. Now, whether this is historically correct or not, modern scholars wonder if this is the correct understanding, if this is actually who the Samaritans were. But no matter, the Jews certainly viewed the Samaritans as foreigners from Mesopotamia who had been imported into that region after the Assyrians conquered the northern kingdom of Israel in 722, 721. You remember when the city of Samaria fell? The Assyrians carted them off and imported foreigners into this territory. And so the Jews understood the Samaritans to be these foreigners who had been imported here long before, centuries before, into this territory of what it was the northern kingdom of Israel. And they also viewed Samaritans as heretics, as people whose Jewish faith had been corrupted by pagan influences. So they were not only foreigners, but they're foreigners who'd come in and had corrupted the Jewish faith. They had twisted it and ruined it. That's why in John notes in John chapter 4, verse 9, Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. They had nothing to do with them. And that's the level that you see here. The Samaritans, on the other hand, they looked at Israel, they thought Israel had apostatized. That's how they saw Israel. Thought they had apostatized beginning as early as the removal of the nation's cultic center from Gerizim to Shiloh and then eventually to Jerusalem. They thought that was an improper move. And so they thought Israel had fallen away from God and they saw themselves as the true people of God. They were the descendants of the faithful remnant, the faithful nucleus of ancient Israel. Now, Jesus' comment in John chapter 4, verse 22, makes clear that they were wrong about that. But that's how they saw themselves, that they were the true Israel, that they were those who were keeping the faith. They were the faithful remnant. Jews saw them as foreigners who'd corrupted the religion. They saw themselves as the real deal, and these people were apostates. So that's what was going on in this relationship. In 128 B.C., just to orient, okay, we're in the first century now with Jesus, but 128 B.C., you had the Jewish leader John Hyrcanus, he destroyed the Samaritan sanctuary at Mount Gerizim. So that didn't really endear the Jews to the Samaritans. And then around A.D., now early first century, A.D. 6 or 7, some Samaritans, they scattered bones in the Jerusalem temple during the Passover. You see, which these things are ritually unclean. So they come into the temple in AD 6 or 7 and they scatter bones during the Passover. Well, you can see some hostility there, right? After the time of Jesus, in AD 52, some Samaritans massacred a group of Galilean pilgrims. Now, though this is after the time of Christ, it says something about the tension and the hostility that existed between Samaritans and the Jews. They slaughtered them, you see. For Jews going to Jerusalem from Galilee, going around rather than through Samaria, it was a matter of safety as well as personal repugnance. It wasn't simply that they had nothing to do with them, couldn't stand these people, and were so put off by them they wanted to go around. They also had to worry about their safety. The hostilities were that bad between Jews and Samaritans. Now, after telling the parable, Jesus asked the lawyer, who, remember, he's seeking a definition of neighbor that will justify his conduct, that will be sufficiently restricted that he will feel good and justified about how he's treating people. So, suck it down, make it narrow, so I can feel like, okay, I'm complying with that, I'm doing that. Neighbor is sufficiently restrictive. Jesus asked him, he says, which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? So he asked this fellow, and he can only answer, the one who had mercy on him. What else is he going to say? So he says, the one who had mercy on him. So the parable pulls the lawyer to rethink his concept of neighbor. That's what Jesus is doing. He pulls the lawyer to rethink his concept of neighbor in asking, who is my neighbor? In asking, who is my neighbor? He was seeking to identify fixed or static markers like nationality, ethnicity, or religion. He wanted these fixed or static markers by which some people could be excluded from the definition. See, that's what he's after. Who is my neighbor? Give me certain set boundaries that are static, that don't move and don't change, so I can then say, they're in, they're out, and make them narrow enough that my conduct will be justified. See, this is what he wants to do. And admitting that the Samaritan proved to be a neighbor to the anonymous victim, he was admitting that one's status as a neighbor is not determined by being in the same or similar social classification or category. So neighbor, in the command to love one's neighbor, doesn't limit one's ethical duty to people within certain classes or categories. It refers to anyone within one's reach, within one's ability to help. There are no static, fixed categories by which somebody can be excluded from the definition. Included within the definition of neighbor, to whom one owes a duty, that one is to, the person you are to love, is anybody within your reach and your ability to help. So Jesus is leading this lawyer to see that no human being, regardless of how they're categorized, no human being can be placed beyond one's duty of love, can be written off as someone to whom no ethical duty or obligation is owed. Well, he's not a Jew. I don't know him. He's not of my religion. I don't know him. I don't know him. Give me the categories that are fixed and make them narrow enough that what I'm doing fits. He won't do it. He pulls this person to rethink, what does it mean to be a neighbor? It is not defined by those static categories. It is defined by who is within your reach and who is in need. That's what's going on. And when the lawyer admits implicitly that neighbor, in terms of the commandment to love your neighbor, that includes anyone within one's reach, that anybody like that who needs help, well, then Jesus tells him, you go and do likewise. See, when he concludes implicitly that is the meaning of neighbor in the command, love your neighbor, he then tells him, you go and do likewise. He goes from leading the lawyer to a right perspective on loving one's neighbor to the personal application in the lawyer's life. You go and love your neighbor by having mercy on any human being who is in need within your reach, regardless of how he or she differs from you. You see, that's what Jesus is telling him. That's how this comes up. All right, the fourth subcategory. Here, so we're living as kingdom participants. This is my final category. And if you haven't been in here how I group these things, you might be going, why does he have these categories? What can I tell you? You're too late to the party. But he says, all right, living as kingdom participants, and we have these categories: attitude toward God, living righteously before men, in relation to others, where I put three. Now, the fourth subcategory under this final category is living as kingdom participants, specifically with regard to money. And I tell you, the Bible has a lot to say about money. And we're kind of skittish about it, you see, because that's private. We don't want to pry, all that. The Bible has a lot to say about money and its dangers. And the first one I want to look at here is the parable of the rich fool in Luke chapter 12. The parable of the rich fool, it occurs only in Luke 12, 16 to 21. And it follows immediately after Jesus' warning in Luke 12, 15, where he says, and he said to them, take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. So right here is this warning about the danger of greed or materialism or having an undue attachment to money and things. And then in Luke 16 to 21, and he told them a parable, saying, the land of a rich man produced plentifully. And he thought to himself, what shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops. And he said, I'll do this. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul, your life is required of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. This rich man in this parable, he has such a bountiful crop, mind-blowing crop, that he has barns, and he has built barns in anticipation of harvests, and presumably in anticipation of good harvests. Who would build a barns and say, well, I'm going to make sure that I'm going to build it to the minimal conceivable harvest, so that as soon as I have a foreseeable harvest, foreseeably large harvest, then I'm going to have to tear them. No. Barns are sizable, built in anticipation of a reasonably large. He gets such a windfall that he can't even store them in the barns he's built. He has something like that, such a bountiful crop, he doesn't even have room to store them. Now, sharing his bounty, this tremendous bounty that he's received, sharing his bounty with the poor never crosses his mind. Doesn't even enter into it. Here you are, you've got barns, you have a crop that is large enough to stuff all of your barns with plenty left over. What does he do? Does he think, wow, I could have all my barns stuffed and I could give the others to people in need? Not at all. Doesn't think about that one bit. Doesn't think about the poor at all. Instead, he plans to build bigger barns so he can keep all of it for his own use and ensure that he has easy living in the future. Now, he's labeled fool. That's not something you want to be called by God. He's labeled a fool because he chose to hoard his wealth, to hoard it, rather than be generous with it as God demands. And he's going to die in that hoarding, hard-hearted state this very night. So the very night that he's being hard-hearted toward the poor and ignoring God's desire that you be generous, he said, what are you, crazy? I've got all this stuff. I'm not even going to give a thought to the poor, though I know God wants the poor to be cared for. I'm not even going to think about that. I'm going to tear down my barns. I'll build bigger ones. I'll have the place stuffed. I will live me, me, me. And he says, you're going to die tonight in that state of hard-heartedness. You're going to die. Regardless, I know you have plans, your plans notwithstanding. I'll have much for many years stored up. You and I aren't in control of this life. Has that dawned on you yet? You and I do not control how long we live. But this is his idea. And he's called a fool because he's going to die this very night, his expectation of many more years notwithstanding. Now, not only will he not enjoy the fruit of his hoarding, so he's a fool for that. He says, who's going to get it then? You're going to be dead. You're not going to be getting all this stuff that you crammed into these new barns. But the implication is that he'll be called to account for his lack of discipleship, for his refusal to embrace the ethics of the kingdom of God. His refusal to embrace those ethics and get on board with God's revolution and say, I am going to live for God, and God would have me be generous with the things that I have. So more than simply his missing out on the fruit of his hoarding, the implication is that he's going to be called to account for his lack of discipleship. God will not be concerned at that time with how full his barns are. Do you think that will matter? Well, I've got plenty of, I got a lot of stuff. Look at it. Did you see my barns? Did you see how much stuff? Have you seen my house? Have you seen my cars? Have you seen how much stuff I got? Do you know what I'm worth? Do you know that I built a huge company? Do you know all of this stuff? Do you think God will be impressed with that? He will not. He will be concerned with, have you lived as my disciple? Have you lived by, have you lived to glorify me in this world? Have you lived as a follower of my son? That's what he'll want to know. See, that's going to be the real question. David Wenham, in his commentary on the parables, he says, living for the revolution, this is being a Christian. As Jesus comes in the kingdom, he introduces the kingdom, inaugurates it, and we fall in behind him as revolutionaries of God. He says, living for the revolution is the antithesis of living selfishly. Who can deny that? When our Lord gave his life for other people. He says, and just for the here and now. It's the antithesis of living selfishly and just for the here and now. It involves being rich towards God. Investing in God's bank. What does he mean by that? It means living in a way that God calls us to live. Being faithful disciples. Expressing our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus in this world by living as he calls us to live. What does that include? It includes being generous with what he has given us. It is this notion of stewardship of all that we have. Stewardship of wealth, stewardship of opportunities, all of these things have been given to us by God, and we are under a responsibility as disciples to use them all in the way we perceive our Lord would have us use them. And so here's this guy, no thought of that at all. All he sees is I can cram and I can build bigger barns and I can do this kind of thing. And Daryl Bach says, the parable does not condemn planning or wealth per se. You see, so if you've got an IRA or any of these things, it's not necessarily about that, right? He says, Jesus' complaint is against the person who takes wealth and directs it totally toward the self. He's not being a steward. Do you see? We all are stewards of what we have, so we're always thinking, what is the good use of this money? Some planning is good and wise and will ease the burden on your family. So there's no need to be guilty about that. But we are stewards, and the question is, what are we doing with it? Are we wrestling with these things and saying, how would the Lord have me use this money? Where can I put this money to work that he will be glorified, good will be done? This guy with these barns, he could have helped poor people. But it doesn't even cross his mind. It was all about him. And see, that is not discipleship, because it involves this idea and includes this notion of stewardship over all that we have, including our wealth. Okay, so we've got specifically with regard to money, we've got the rich fool. First bell, let's see how far I get here. That is the first bell, right? Wayne told me, you don't always hear that bell. I said, duh, yeah. All right, the unjust steward. We can't get through this, I don't think. But the parable of the unjust steward, this occurs only in Luke 16, 1-9, and Snodgrass describes this parable as notoriously difficult. Here it is, 16, 1-9. He also said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. This manager's incompetent. You've employed a guy to manage your stuff, and he's a doofus. He's just wasting everything. He's no good. And he called him and said to him, what is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager. And the manager said to himself, what shall I do since my master is taking the management away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig, that's me, and I'm ashamed to beg, also. I've decided what to do so that when I'm removed from management, people may receive me into their houses. So summoning his master's debtors, one by one, he said to the first, how much do you owe my master? He said, 100 measures of oil. He said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, And how much do you owe? He said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. Now, the manager was an agent of the owner, someone with the authority of the owner. He could act on the owner's behalf. And the debtors probably were people who had contracted with the owner to farm out the owner's land in exchange for giving the owner a portion of the produce. And the owner's satisfied from reports that he hears that the manager is incompetent. And he fires the manager, and he demands that the manager give an accounting of his management as a way of wrapping up matters. Okay, so he's going to fire him, but he wants to know, where do I stand? You can't just go and leave, and somebody else has to come in and do it. You have to give me an accounting. I got to know, where are we? Who owes me what? What are we doing? So he tells him to wrap up things and give him an accounting, because he's out. So this is what's going on. So he has that with the manager. The manager then cheats the owner. He cheats the owner by reducing what the debtors owe him. And he does that in order to ingratiate himself with the debtors. That's why he's labeled in verse 8 as dishonest or unrighteous. So you get the picture, right? I mean, here's this guy. He's out in the cold. He's been fired. But he's saying, what can I do? So he says, I will suck up to the debtors so they will view me favorably. So when I'm gone, I can get in with them. And so he cheats the owner by saying, here, reduce what you really, in fact, owe my owner. He'll never know, and it'll be our little secret, and then you will owe me, and you will be open to taking me. So he's planning, you see, for his future. That's what he's doing with this. Now, so the reductions that the manager makes, by the way, they're quite substantial. There are 100 baths. Here says measures. 100 baths of oil, that'd be about 800 or 900 gallons, which would be the equivalent of about 3 years of wages for an average worker. And there goes the second bell. So I just have to figure out, how do we get back to this place next week, Lord willing. Thank you for coming.